Hi everyone, welcome. So glad you are here and celebrating this Palm Sunday morning together. Thank you for being here and creating this space together. Interact online right here on YouTube and Facebook. Say hello, let us know you are here. You can share prayers at Sanctuary's worship group on Facebook too. Like many of you, I have found a corner of my living room to sit in, and I found a spot today next to something green to remind me and to remind you that today is Palm Sunday, marking the beginning of Holy Week. And as we walk through all the emotions of this week, especially this year, stay connected to each other. Stay connected to the people in your life who are life-giving to you, and stay connected with Sanctuary too. There is lots happening at Sanctuary this week. Small groups are happening, kids time, youth group is happening, Friday night fun is happening, and I would love to see all of you at morning coffee any day. You are invited to all of it. So keep a close eye on Facebook. Keep a close eye on your email this week, and keep a close eye on Sanctuary's website too. We have lots to share with each other this week. Videos, songs, ideas for getting your house ready for Easter, and another opportunity for worship later in the week. So stay connected. And we would love your help in creating something special for Sanctuary's Easter celebration. Here's the deal. You know our favorite song, or one of our favorite songs at Sanctuary, Love Can Change the World. Well, we need video clips of you and your living room dance party, lip syncing, rocking out, head bopping to that really great tune. You can find all the directions and a link to that song right on Sanctuary's website at sanctuarysouthshore.org. So we hope to hear from you this week. Welcome to worship. We are so glad you are here. Peace.
I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Generation rising up to take their place. Selfless faith, selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray. Hosanna, Hosanna, show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As a walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Good morning. Okay.
Good morning. So, Ezri and I find ourselves this morning with 300 palm branches because months ago we ordered 300 palm branches to help us celebrate Palm Sunday. So since you can't, you know, have fun with these palms at home, I encourage you to take a moment and go and find something similar. You might have a house plant or maybe a coat or a blanket or something that you can wave around and help us celebrate this story. Welcome back. Ezri has abandoned me, but my trusty steed, Graham, he's gonna hang out and hear this story, our Palm Sunday story. Friends, Jesus said to his disciples, I need to go to Jerusalem. I've got some important things to do, and I want to celebrate Passover with you there. Will you come with me? Sure, said the disciples. Passover is a great holiday. Such good food, and what a wonderful story Passover celebrates. The exodus of God's people, the Israelites, from Egypt. It's good to be with friends and family at Passover. So Jesus and his friends started to go to Jerusalem. When they got close to the city, Jesus said, I'd like two of you to borrow a donkey in the village, in the next village over. Please tell the owner that I need it. He'll understand. When the two friends came back with a donkey, Jesus climbed on its back and rode down the hill into the city of Jerusalem. The disciples followed behind him. Suddenly, they found themselves in a parade. People were singing and shouting, Hosanna! Hosanna! Here comes God's King! Hosanna! Praise God! This is your moment. Hosanna! Hosanna! People all over heard the shouting and the singing, and they joined the parade too. Hundreds of people, thousands of people. They started taking off their coats and laying them on the ground for Jesus and the donkey to walk on. And they pulled palm branches down from the trees, and they waved them as they sang. And they threw their palms on the ground to make a path for Jesus. The crowds gave Jesus a royal welcome as he rode into the city, just like a king. But Jesus was a very different king. He was a king of peace. Not everyone understood that. Jesus was not at all what they were expecting. They thought the crowd was too loud and the parade was getting too big. Who is that man? Someone asked. What's going on here? Asked another. And the crowd answered, This is Jesus, God's king. He has come to save us. Some of the religious leaders murmured, Hush, Jesus, tell your friends to be quiet. It's way too loud here. But Jesus said, we can try to make these people quiet, but that wouldn't make a difference because today the whole earth is celebrating.
Go on up to the mountain of mercy, to the crimson perpetual tide. Kneel down on the shore, be thirsty no more. Go under, be purified. Follow Christ to the holy mountain. Sinners sorry and wrecked by the fall, cleanse your heart and your soul in the fountain that flows for you and for me and for all. At the wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night, you and me were atoned by his blood and forever washed white. On that beautiful, scandalous night, on the hillside you will be delivered. At the foot of the cross justified, and in your spirit restored by the river that pours from our blessed Savior's side. At the wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night, you and me were atoned by his blood and forever washed white. Mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night, you and me were atoned by his blood and forever washed white. On that beautiful, scandalous night,
morning. This is a strange week in our cycle of the church year and the ways that we tell the story of God and the world of Jesus. And it's strange because we smash together these two traditions. We, at least at Sanctuary, struggle to figure out which way to go, and so we sort of do both. We have this big triumphant parade, celebration, this entry of Jesus into Jerusalem that reminds us of all the hope, the possibility, the passion that people feel for the way that Jesus is going to change things right here and right now. And then, in short course, in the same service, in the same moment, we shift to the rest of that story, to just a few days later. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus said, "If you say so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. And Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now, at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner from the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. And at that time, a notorious criminal named Barabbas was also gathered together with Jesus. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Who do you want me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priest had handed him over. While he was sitting on his judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with this innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." Now the chief priest and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor said again to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what should I do with Jesus who is called the Messiah?" And all of them said, "Let him be crucified." And then he asked, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." "Do nothing," Pilate thought. "I can do nothing." Rather than a riot beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." And the people as a whole answered, "His blood be on us and our children." And so he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers of the governor took Jesus to the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand, and they knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And after mocking him, they stripped him of the robe, and they put his own clothes on him. And then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. But he tasted it, and he would not drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. And they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." And two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross in the same way the chief priests say, also with the scribes and the elders, save yourself." They said, "He saved others, but he cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him if he wants to. For he said, 'I am God's son.'" The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried with a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "This man is calling for Elijah." And one of them ran and got a sponge and filled it with sour wine and put it on a stick and gave it to him to drink. But the other said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come and save him." And then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At this moment, the curtain in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, rocks were split, the tombs were also opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said, "Truly this man was God's son." What's fascinating to me is the shift in the people in these two stories. There's a crowd that we hear about at the beginning, a crowd gathered together to see what God is doing. They are filled full of hope, of expectation. And they are ready as Jesus rides in this humble way to Jerusalem for all of their hopes and dreams to be fulfilled. They are waiting. They're wishing, they're longing for the brokenness that they see all around them, for the tragedy that they see unfold, that happens day to day in their life and in society, and just the way people are connected and gathered and fighting and vying for power and control. They want Jesus to be the one who steps in and fills all those vacuums, who knocks all these corrupt rulers from their thrones, who fixes all of their problems, who heals all wounds. And they are excited. They are jubilant when they gather their coats and their palm fronds and they spread them out before him. They make a way so that it might just accelerate his entry into this moment to claim this throne, to be the one who fixes this mess. And then Jesus continues doing what he does. He goes to the temple and reminds people that a house of prayer is not to be a house where goods are bought and sold at the expense of others. I mean, he reminds people what it looks like to love others as God loves them, to see all of his teachings in a very tangible and real way unfold. And that, unfortunately, is not fast enough for everybody. It is not what people pictured. Might be able to hear traffic whizzing by. Even with nowhere to go, people have plenty of places to be. We now totally understand this need for instant gratification. The way that we get grumpy or angry when those things that we used to be able to get in 2 days or less for free now might take a little bit longer. Might have a few more barriers or obstacles to getting to us. I mean, that stuff that we want to see happen, when it doesn't happen as fast as we expect it, it is really easy for our tempers to sour, for our winds to shift and change, for us to have a totally different way of interacting with those around us, of understanding our place in life. I mean, all of that comes in a way that we feel and we express to our loved ones and in our actions. And it's gross, isn't it? You ever been in that moment where you just didn't quite have things come together in the way that you wanted to, as quickly as you wanted to? There are a lot of people right now that are struggling and scrambling and trying to do things, and they feel the anxiety of needing to get them done and accomplished for all sorts of great and noble reasons. And when they don't happen instantly, look at the conversations and the broken relationships and the challenge that takes place. And it's in that mindset that the people shift, they change from this parade, this triumphal gathering, to using all of the palms and the branches and the things that we were laying down to make Jesus' path forward smooth, to use them as fuel for the fire of their frustration and their anger, to see their rage billow up and start to fill and consume them to this point that they don't even know why they're necessarily angry, but they know somebody needs to pay to suffer, to be the one who takes on all of their anxiety for them. And so we see this crowd of people that gathers together and sentences Jesus to death, not out of any sort of rational, logical motive, no, out of jealousy, out of fear, out of frustration that their desires have not been fulfilled as quickly as they thought they would. Here's the thing. We have this notion that yes, this world is not the way it's meant to be. I mean, I think more than ever right now, we can affirm that things are probably not the way that God intends them to be in this world. And to understand that brokenness, we could reflect on our own contributions, the ways that we don't necessarily help that cause, or we could find somebody to blame. And so the people in this moment project that angst, that rage onto Jesus, but we are just as guilty, just as capable of trying to find excuses and ways to disregard our neighbors, our families, the things and the people that we care about, because we are just frustrated and we don't know what to do with it. See, the people, we want things to be fixed now, instantly. Don't you? Wouldn't it be nice if we could just say, all right, back to normal. Things are all set. We have figured them out. I get caught up in the same cycle. I see these stories about promises that seem too good to be true, but I love it, and I read it, and I soak in the hope that is latent in it, even if it's not really all that put together, even if it's sort of starting to flare up and be possible, and then it's starting to tamper down again with reality. I still love that feeling of hope that comes from thinking that everything might just be fixed instantly. And the people laying down their palm branches and their coats and yelling Hosanna, they're doing these things because they expect Jesus in that moment to come sweeping in with power and authority and violence and a army and all of those things that we associate with taking charge and taking control. And they are expecting him by force to make things right. But Jesus' message doesn't change. The hope that he preaches is not a hope of instant gratification. It is a hope rooted in the promise that God, who created this world and you and me and everything in it, that God is so committed to this project, to his people, that God is not going anywhere. It is a hope latent in the story that even when our ugliness and our anxiety and our violence projects itself onto an innocent person in ways that have terrible consequences, that even in the middle of the symbol of the death represented by the cross, we are able to see God's presence rising up, surprising us in an act of sacrifice, a gift of love deeper and more profound than anything we could have imagined. That replacing our need for instant solutions and answers, replacing our desire to have everything resolved and wrapped up in 48 minutes so we can feel good about moving on to the next story, replacing all of that is a promise so much deeper or more profound that there is nothing that we can do, even out of the depths of our rage and our anxiety and our violence, that will push God's love away. That through Jesus, finally, once and for all, in a symbol that is so crystal and clear and stark, one that we continue to wear around and talk about and gather in front of week after week after week, in the symbol of the cross, we are reminded that even at the peak of everything that we think is final and finished and cut and dry, God surprises us. God surprises us by embracing that moment, not in violence or in rage or anger himself, but instead embracing that moment in this beautiful self-sacrificial love. And what really cooks my noodle is that we, as people of hope in God's commitment, God's deep love for us in this world, we as people of hope also lay claim to this very bizarre and beautiful reality that a God who knows all and sees all and has this perspective that is bigger and broader and more beautiful than anything we could possibly conjure up, that same God is willing to experience on the cross what it means to be in a dark and deadly place. That God is willing to come into the depths of our human experience, into our own experiences and struggles with mortality and even death, to be the recipient of our basest instincts, our worst sides, to know what it feels like to be forsaken, to be crucified, to be sacrificed. And yet that same God will, spoilers, surprise us with where that presence, that empathy, that experience will then lead in just a few short days. May we be people who resist the things that our needs for instant gratification pull out of us. Our impatience, our frustration, our anxiety. I mean, may we be people who place our hope not in easy answers or quick responses, not in the flash and excitement and enthusiasm of a parade, because I guarantee that all those things at one minute will be raging and exciting, and at another minute will start to die away and fizzle out. May we instead place our faith, our hope in this story of God's presence in this world, in even the darkest and ugliest places, that God continues to surprise us with the depths of love that we are able to experience and see and share as God's people. In a moment where everything seems to just be out of control, chaotic and beyond our ability to understand or manage, may we be people who are grateful and share this good news that it is not up to us to figure this out, that the depths of God's compassion and love for us in this place will allow us to sink back in confidence and hope that God is not going anywhere, that we are part of this great gift that we have seen through Jesus on the cross, of a love unending, a love never dying, a love that continues to remind us again and again that we too are able to love. There are a lot of neighbors, a lot of friends, a lot of people in our community who are isolated or scared or fearful, and we are given this gift of being able to love, confident that we too are deeply loved. It's a weird moment. It's a weird juxtaposition. We feel it so deeply now as we are isolated and yet spring is springing up. We also feel it in all of the anxiety and the tension that we carry with us and the uncertainty in this moment. And may we, as people of hope, also take this moment to soak in the depths of God's love and commitment for us in this world. Amen.
Every day we go to war again, we assume we know so much more than them before we hear what they have to say. Headline breaks and we start to hate again, calling them names again. We give our peace away. I hope they see it, 'cause I wanna see it. I hope we believe it. I wanna see the love is away again. We know that there is is pain within. We cannot medicate. Learn to feel.
As we enter into a time of prayer, I invite you to find a position or posture that's comfortable for you as we pray. Prayers for Caitlin. For God's peace in our lives during this scary time. For all our healthcare workers and all essential employees, keep them safe. Prayers for Cassie and all those with cancer. Help us to find a cure. Continued prayers for Charlie and his parents. For my sister, a nurse on the front lines, as she cares for her patients and her young children daily. For all seniors to feel supported by their community and have adequate groceries. For us all to see God's presence each and every day. For Joanne and Gino, who are battling COVID, keep them safe and heal them. Into your hands, O God, we lift these prayers and those on our hearts to you as we say together, Amen.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died.
Thank you for joining us for worship this morning. We're so glad that you were able to be here. As we go from this place, I encourage you to pop over to our Facebook group to continue to share your prayers and peace with one another. Also, as always, we are so grateful and thankful for the ways that you are supporting Sanctuary in this challenging time. And so if you are able, I invite you to also go to sanctuarysouthshore.org/give and to continue to do that in whatever way you are able. God bless, God's peace, and have a great week.
But first, while you're searching your house for something, there's a word that comes up in the story that you should know. It's Hosanna. Can you try that?
Hosanna.
Hosanna. Yeah. Hosanna. And you're going to wave whatever you have, whether it's a leaf or a jacket or a blanket or whatever you found. You're going to say, you're going to wave it around. You're going to say, Hosanna.
Hosanna.
Yeah. All right. All right. So that's going to happen later in the story.
I want to pick it off.
You want me to hold it for a second?
No.
You want to? Okay. Such good food, and what a wonderful story.
I want the wolf mama.
Passover celebrates.
I want the wolf dada.
Okay.
All right. I want to go there.